Hey everyone, it's Blockchain Bernie here with my latest episode, and this one is about storage cost on the Solana chain and also on Ethereum. And I'll tell you, you will be surprised. You will be very surprised when I reveal that secret on how much it costs to store some data, larger amounts of data, on these chains. So if you like content like this, please give me that thumbs up. It really helps the YouTube algorithm. And also leave me a comment here and subscribe to my channel. All right, so storage, right? So that means we have these smart contract platforms, and I'm going to be revealing the storage costs today in this video for both Solana and for Ethereum, right? And why am I talking Solana and Ethereum and not like Filecoin or Arweave or stuff like that? Very simple, because I'm talking about storage for smart contracts, storage for programs, for code that runs on the blockchain and that needs storage, right? Because that's what we need in Web3, right? Web3 is about applications that run code, but also store data, right? Just as the Web2 applications that we have out there, right? If you think of Web2 apps like Airbnb, like eBay, like Twitter or X now, and all these other platforms, they run code on their servers, but they also store a lot of data on their servers. And the code needs to access that data really quickly, right? And you know, things like Arweave and Filecoin and stuff like that, they're more like, you know, standalone storage solutions. Arweave is not even a storage solution, it's an archival solution. That's why it's called Arweave, right? It's you just write once and then it's there forever. You can't update it, you can't delete it or anything. But for writing apps, for writing Web3 apps, we need that, you know, possibility to make updates, to delete stuff, and have some random access storage, just as Web2 servers have it for decades, right? Every normal server has access to storage, but just the smart contract platforms, well, they have access to storage, but you'll be surprised how much it'll cost you. So let's dive into it. So here's what it costs on Solana. And, you know, I've made an assumption here for a Sol price of $25. That's, you know, kind of the average of the past month or so, 30 days. And that's a rough estimate, right? So these prices fluctuate. I just made it simple and say, well, let's assume one Sol costs $25, right? And then on Solana, the so-called rent per byte year is 0.00000348 Sol, right? So that's like a tiny amount, tiny fraction of a cent here that it costs to store one byte per year. But you'll have to pay for 2 years, right, to be rent exempt. So it was like in the early days of Solana, it was like you had to pay rent. That means, you know, the cost for storage is proportional to the time you store it. And when you delete it, then you stop paying rent, right? So you move out, so to speak. But they changed that, and you'd have to pay for 2 years to be rent exempt. And that's the only option right now in the newer Solana releases, right? In former times, it was really like you could pay rent, but now you'd have to pay for 2 years. And if you really use it for 2 years or longer, that's what you're going to end up paying. And if you do it shorter and you delete it before the 2 years have passed, then you get some of your money back. But let's just assume you use it for 2 years or longer here, which is a normal case in Web3 apps, right? So the cost for 1 kilobyte then, for 1,000 bytes, will cost you 17.4 cents then, right? That sounds like a fair deal. I mean, 17 cents is not a lot of money, and you can store a kilobyte there. A megabyte will already be $174 here. And then if you go for 1 gigabyte and think about 1 gigabyte, it's not a lot of data for a Web3 app, right? I mean, it's just 1 gigabyte. And it's going to cost you $174,000. Think about that. So now, if you really build a Web3 version of Airbnb, if you really build all these Web2 apps that we have out there today, and they are all centralized, right? And that's what we want to do. We want to move to that new world where everything's decentralized, where control is decentralized, where, you know, you cannot be arbitrarily censored or stuff like that, right? So we need some sort of content moderation. Don't get me wrong, right? I'm not one of those guys that says, you know, everyone can do whatever they want. There will be rules, but these rules will be in the code and they will be public and things like that, right? So that's why we want to build these Web3 apps. And and you know, even 1 terabyte is $174 million on Solana, which is one of the cheapest smart contract platforms, right? So that would be prohibitive for most, you know, Web3 apps. $174 million for just 1 terabyte. I mean, we all have 1 terabyte in our laptops today, right? And for these server apps, 1 terabyte is nothing, right? So if you need 1 petabyte, which is 1,000 terabytes, right, you end up paying $174 billion, right? Which is prohibitive for almost anyone, right? And most likely, many of these apps need exabytes of storage. And if it's 1 exabyte, you know, it's $174 billion, so it's $174 trillion. That is more than, you know, the United States GDP and everything, right? It is crazy. And this is on Solana. It's one of the cheapest. So now let's look into Ethereum, right? At, you know, an average cost per ETH of $1,850. Again, that's roughly like the average over the past 30 days. And yeah, let's look into ETH here, right? So the cost per byte is 640 gas. And I assumed like the gas price fluctuates wildly on Ethereum. For the past 30 days, it has been hovering around 30 Gwei, right? Sometimes more, sometimes less. It's, you know, fluctuating a lot. I just assumed 30 Gwei. That was kind of the average over the past 30 days. And that would put us, and 1 Gwei is just another word for a billionth of an ETH. So, and it's 640 gas at 30 Gwei. That puts us at, you know, 0.0192 ETH. And at the $850 per ETH, that'd be $34 to store 1 byte. All right. For 1 kilobyte, that will already be $480. Whoo. For just 1 kilobyte. And remember, it was 17 cents on Solana, right? So the factor Solana to Ethereum here is about 2,750, right? So it costs 2,758x more on Ethereum to store data than it costs on Solana, right? One of the reasons we're using Solana as the basis for our Xandeum chain. All right, so for 1 megabyte, which is almost nothing, right? You already pay $480,000. And for 1 gigabyte, it's $480 million. Think about it. And for 1 terabyte, again, I have 1 terabyte on this MacBook here. To store the whole contents of my MacBook on Ethereum, it would cost me, you know, the sum of $480 billion. That's half, almost half a trillion dollars, right? And then for 1 petabyte and for 1 exabyte, you know, I don't even pronounce these numbers here, right? So what does that all mean? It means we have no means available as of today to have smart contract use a lot of storage, right? So we cannot write real Web3 apps, right? Because what's Web3 supposed to be? It's supposed to bring, you know, the features of blockchain, right? Being all decentralized control and, you know, having censorship resistance and all these type of things, right? That was the original vision of Satoshi Nakamoto when he invented Bitcoin, right? It's, you know, getting rid of centralized organizations that, you know, control our lives. We want to be the ones to control our lives and to control our destiny, right? And in order to build these Web3 apps, it's just not possible with today's technology, right? We have these smart contract chains, and I showed you how much it costs to store data there. And then we have some storage chains that are just not built to support Web3 apps. It's not easy to build code on a smart contract that uses these storage chains to have random access to data, right? It's not designed for that, and these storage chains are all standalone. They don't really help building Web3 apps. So that's why I'm so excited about adding that storage layer to smart contract platforms. And we're using the top technology here, which is Solana, which gives us a lot of blockchain and block space and is scalable, right? The reason it's so expensive on Ethereum is just because Ethereum is by far not as scalable as Solana is. And then, you know, some people do L2s on top of Ethereum, but these L2s have issues also because they're siloed then, right? So we're using Solana as that, and then we're using the storage technology that has been pioneered by, you know, companies like Sia or Filecoin or stuff like that. They're not even companies, let's say chains like Sia and Filecoin. And we're borrowing from their technologies, but we're connecting that to the smart chains. We will be using the Move language to make it super easy for a programmer that develops a Web3 app to access that storage, right? Because the Move language has a paradigm to access storage, right? And usually that is being used to access like the Solana accounts, right? The Solana accounts is what I just showed you, right? This is to store data on Solana accounts, right? It's going to cost you that money that I've shown you here. And we're using the Move language to access the delegated storage that's delegated out there to the storage provider nodes, right? So that's the trick that we're going to apply here. Not store the data on each and every validator. That's the reason it's so expensive, right? We are delegating that to a set of storage providers, and there will be millions of storage providers on the Xandeum chain with, you know, cheap consumer devices, but they need to be connected to SSDs. And these are also out there on consumer grade SSDs are out there everywhere. And we are going to be storing that data redundantly on these storage providers. The validator nodes will make sure that the storage providers do what they're supposed to do, store that data. They will challenge them, you know, each and every slot, each and every block on the Solana chain, store the zero knowledge proofs on the Solana chain, and all these things. And I feel that is a super, super exciting thing. And it's going to be changing the world. And it's going to be a big step to move from, you know, programmable blockchain that was pioneered by Ethereum, which was a big, big thing. But it's going to be just as big a thing to add that storage layer to it so that finally we can develop real, real apps on the blockchain, right? As we've been able to on Web2 for ages. But right now, the technology is just not there. And it reminds me a little bit of my time in university back in the 80s when I was really interested in AI. And AI was super, super cool. Everyone was excited about the possibilities of the technology, but it wasn't possible to build anything, right? It was just the feasibility of the projects that were there. They were so disappointing compared to what people imagined, what could we do with AI, right? But we couldn't back in the day. And it took decades until artificial neural networks were invented, right? And once that base technology with ANNs, artificial neural networks, was there, there was an explosion in AI. And suddenly, you know, suddenly we could actually do it. What we envisioned was possible with AI. And I feel like with Web3, we're at the same phase right now. Everyone's envisioning, what could we do with Web3? But in the end, you know, it's all just marketing phrases right now, because we cannot really build Web3 apps because the base technology is missing or prohibitively expensive, as I've shown you in this video, right? So with Xandeum and building that storage layer connected to smart contracts, we are solving that, and we are building that base technology that will make Web3 possible. And, you know, I believe Web3 is going to be a very, very big thing, just as big as AI is these days. And it will help AI, by the way. It will help prove what's human-made and what's AI generated, and you know, keep the governance up there about content, and, you know, prove content authenticity and all these type of things, right? So we almost need Web3 to keep AI under control, and we need that new base technology that we are building here, and that's going to be the basis for, you know, for that explosion, that almost Cambrian explosion that's going to happen on Web3. But we need that base technology to make it happen, and we're building that at Xandeum, and I'm super proud of that. Go to xandeum.com, check out what we're doing, check our white paper, check our light paper, buy a node in order to be part of this movement from very, very early on. And so far, thanks for watching, and catch you guys later. Bye.